The following program, The Russ Belville Show, is intended for responsible adults only. We advocate to the repeal of marijuana prohibition for adults. We discuss the science, culture, and controversy about America's marijuana laws. We do not advocate any illegal activity and encourage all listeners to learn their state and federal marijuana laws. Opinions and claims made by guests and advertisers on The Russ Belville Show are their own, and The Russ Belville Show cannot be held legally responsible for their validity or reliability. Viewer discretion is advised.
You take a seed, you plant it, you grow it, you dry it, you roll it, you smoke it. You take a seed, you plant it, you grow it, you dry it, you roll it, you smoke it,
and it goes down smooth. Hey!
Spanning the continent to bring you the truth about cannabis and marijuana law reform.
I smoke pot and I like it a lot.
From the promise of legalization. Of prohibition.
One major responsibility is to encourage people to use less drugs.
The Russ Belville Show, the voice of the marijuana nation.
Yeah, I hear you had a question for me.
Now, here's your host, Radical Russ Belville.
We love it.
Good day, tokers and tokettes, and welcome. It is Tuesday, April 16th, 2013, and it's got to be 420 somewhere in the world. So glad you could join us for today's show. All sorts of news and information to get to. Starting with our 420 radio news, we've got headlines coming out of Kansas where the governor has signed the drug testing for welfare and unemployment benefits bill, one of many that are going through state legislatures. We'll get you caught up on all of those in our 420 radio news. It's coming up right after our first break. Also on today's show, we're going to go behind the headlines. And in behind the headlines today, you may have seen from my Twitter feed that I've discovered these cases out of Sacramento, California, that have proven that once and for all, growing pot is worse than raping a mentally and physically handicapped woman. That's right, at least if you judge by the sentences given out in these cases. We'll tell you all those details in behind the headlines. Also on today's show, we're continuing our Cheech and Chong New Music Week. We got new music from Cheech and Chong's animated movie musical soundtrack album, Never Heard Before. You can hear them right here on 420 Radio. At 20 after for today, it's Electric Tuesday, so we've got kind of an electronic-y tune from Cheech and Chong called Paranoid Pothead. So we'll check that out at 20 after. We hope you join us and enjoy that as well. At half past on Tuesdays now, we've been doing a little thing I call reefer research, and I'm going to take you into what is called the treatment episode data set admissions. This is all of the information data collected by the Substance Abuse Mental Health Service Agency, SAMHSA, that keeps track of who is admitted to drug rehab, why are they admitted to rehab, and what forced them to go into rehab. The stats for marijuana smokers are pretty shocking. We'll tell you. Take a look at that and show you how the drug rehab industry depends on putting us in rehab, because the other guys, they don't rehab so well. It doesn't make your statistics look very good. Then at the end of the show, we'll have time for a radical rant. You know me, I've got my eye on Kevin Sabet and Project Sam. They were recently out on the big island of Hawaii, and Hawaii 24/7 has given a write-up on Project Sam. So I'm going to debunk just about everything they had to say so that our friends out there in Hawaii can get all of the right facts and information. Just like our friend Hi in Hawaii, one of our longtime listeners right here at 420radio.org, you can become a VIP. Help support this independent media. Visit 420radio.org and choose support us on the main menu if you'd like to help. We've got to take a break. We'll be right back.
We'll be right back after these messages from our 420 friendly sponsors. Support these advertisers because their ad money goes straight to the Russ Belville Show. You're tuned into the Russ Belville Show, the voice of the marijuana nation.
What's happening, funky brothers and soul sisters? This is Big Daddy, and I want you to win a t-shirt courtesy of the Funky Roller Rink at 420radio.org. Just tune into the Funky Roller Rink this week and keep track of all the hip-hop tunes and sample my Funk 3, baby. Music makes
can dig the groove.
Then, the following week, at the start of the show, just tweet at Funky Roller Ring the results of the hip-hop set list in the order they were played. The first three skaters with the correct set list win some free threads, baby. But you gotta watch the show to win. It's the Sample My Funk t-shirt contest this week on the Funky Roller Ring. Check out the Funky Roller Rink blog on 420radio.org for more info. And as always, keep it funky, keep it funky, keep it funky.
I'm Sub Cool from Team Green Avenger. At TGAGenetics.com, we are working on the leading edge of medical strains. Our strains are rigorously tested for THC, CBD, THCV, and other critical cannabinoids. Know your grow. Check out our genetic diversity at TGAGenetics.com, the home of Jelly Bean, Jack the Ripper, Vortex, and other award-winning cannabis strains.
This is your 420 Radio News for Tuesday, April 16th, 2013. I'm Russ Belville. Governor signs Kansas drug test law for aid recipients from Seattle Post-Intelligencer. Governor Sam Brownback said Tuesday that a new law requiring applicants for a welfare program to submit to drug testing was a step toward ending a scourge on the state and break the cycle of poverty. The Republican governor signed the bill during a statehouse ceremony, saying that the state had an obligation to help residents break their addictions and improve their lives through treatment and jobs training. The bill would require the Department of Children and Family Services to screen individuals for illegal drug use when they apply for unemployment or temporary assistance to needy families. For anyone who tests positive for drugs, the state would provide mandatory drug treatment and job skills training funded by that program or Medicaid. The bill also covers residents who fail a pre-employment drug screening from being eligible for unemployment benefits. Applicants must submit to drug screening, and if they test positive, they would have to complete a treatment program and job skills training. Failure to complete treatment or jobs training would disqualify applicants from receiving unemployment benefits. Marijuana research funding cut as support for drug grows. This from Bloomberg. As more states embrace legalized marijuana, the drug's growing medicinal use has highlighted a disturbing fact for doctors. Scant research exists to support marijuana's health benefits. What's more, the federal government is scaling back its research funding. U.S. spending has dropped 31% since 2007, when it peaked at $131 million, according to the National Institutes of Health Research Database. Last year, 235 projects received $91 million of public funds, according to NIH data. Fewer than 20 randomized controlled trials, the gold standard for clinical research, involving only about 300 patients, have been conducted on smoked marijuana over the last 35 years, according to the American Medical Association, the U.S.'s largest doctor group. Marijuana advocates point out inherent obstacles to conducting research. The National Institute on Drug Abuse controls all the cannabis used in approved trials, but the agency's mandate is to study abuse of drugs, not health benefits. NIDA also administered the most projects from 2003 to 2012, overseeing $713 million split among 1,837 research efforts. The bulk of the funding in the past decade was devoted to evaluating marijuana's risks, potential negative impacts on the brain, and developing prevention and treatment strategies, according to NIDA. Group of Illinois doctors backs medical marijuana legislation from CBS Chicago. Illinois lawmakers could vote on legislation to legalize medical marijuana this week, and a group of 250 doctors has urged them to support the measure. They said those who benefit from medical marijuana should be able to obtain it safely and legally. Marijuana Policy Project Director Dan Riffle said, "Unlike California, you're not going to be able to doctor shop. You're not going to be able to walk into an office, pay $100, and leave 5 minutes later with a recommendation," end quote. The sponsor, Representative Liu Lang, said his legislation would have the strictest regulations on medical marijuana of any of the states in America. Arkansas Attorney General rejects wording of medical marijuana plan from San Francisco Gate. Arkansas Attorney General Dustin McDaniel has again rejected the wording of a proposed initiated act that would legalize medical marijuana in the state. On Tuesday, McDaniel rejected the wording of the proposed initiated act by Arkansans for Compassionate Care, a group that campaigned for a similar medical marijuana initiative that narrowly failed in the November 2012 general election. McDaniel cited several ambiguities in the ballot measure. Medical marijuana passes New York Assembly Health Committee from Syracuse.com. A committee of New York lawmakers today approved legalizing marijuana production, sales, and use for medical needs. The 21-4 vote in the New York State Assembly Health Committee was not surprising in a chamber that has approved medical marijuana three times since 2008. Also added from HuffingtonPost.com, State Senator Diane Savino of Staten Island and Assemblyman Richard Gottfried of Manhattan, both Democrats, are holding a news conference today in Albany to promote the bill. Gottfried, who championed three medical marijuana bills that passed the Assembly in 2007, 2008, and 2012, but died in the Senate, said he believed this bill might be different. Polls by Quinnipiac University and Cornell University in 2010 showed that about two-thirds of New Yorkers favor allowing medical marijuana use. This has been your 420 Radio News for Tuesday, April 16th, 2013. I'm Russ Belville. When we come back, we go behind the headlines and take a look at two stories from Sacramento, California, showing that, as far as our prison and judicial system are concerned, growing pot is worse than raping a mentally and physically handicapped woman. This is the Russ Belville Show on 420radio.org. We'll be right back.
Mark, welcome home.
Please, come.
Join us.
Mark hasn't smoked weed in about 10 days, and I'm worried about him. I can't watch him destroy himself.
I'm fine, okay? This is none of your business.
Shh. Come, Mark. We're only here because we care.
I'm in control. That's what they don't get, is that I can start smoking weed anytime that I want to. I just don't feel like it right now.
At first, he was, you know, just skipping a day here and there. But then it got more and more consistent, and then he just wasn't smoking any weed at all.
Mark, we haven't smoked a joint together in like 3 weeks, man. I don't know who you are anymore. Your short-term memory is incredible.
You know, I just can't sit back and watch someone destroy their own lives with horrible decisions.
See you guys. Stupid, I'm getting out of here.
Don't touch me!
It hurts me a lot, you know? What do you do for someone that you care about that is ruining their own life? What do you do?
He's not showing any signs of starting.
Intervention on A&E.
What's to keep somebody from getting all potted up on weed and then getting behind the wheel?
The Russ Belville Show reminds you to never smoke and drive impaired. Hang out for a while. Share.
Welcome back, everybody. Time for us to go behind the headlines. And today I saw a post come up on the Google News feed about another pot grower being sentenced to prison. And I was talking about this very subject with someone recently, and I can't remember when or what the context was, but I was pointing out how I don't really do stories on bus very often because it's not really news. It happens every day. Every day someone's going to prison, someone's getting busted. And if I did a story every day on a bus, the news segment would be, you know, 30 minutes long because there's just so many of them. And I was kind of remarking to my friend that, you know, one of the things you can do, and you can play this game at home, Whenever you read of someone getting busted for growing marijuana and what terrible sentence they got handed down, go to your Google News, just news.google.com, type in the name of your county, and then child rape sentence. Like, you know, if it's my home county, it's Multnomah County, child rape sentence. And you will be astonished to find in almost every single case, somebody, a rapist, getting a lower sentence than the person who was just sentenced for growing marijuana. And that was the case today when I was taking a look at some news out of Sacramento. And remember, we're talking about a marijuana grower being sentenced for harvesting a crop that adults wish to purchase. And he's going to spend years behind bars for a crime that now a majority of Americans don't think should even be a crime. And even if we do get legalization in California, I'm sorry, when we get legalization in California in 2016, this guy will still be behind bars. We got to remember that as we legalize, there will still be people serving time for things that will no longer be crimes in our state and our country. So don't ever forget that. Let me read to you from CBS Sacramento. U.S. District Judge William Shubb sentenced 44-year-old Uriel Ochoa Espindola to 17 and a half years in prison for growing tens of thousands of marijuana plants in three different counties in California with his partners and shipping the product across the country with the help of commercial trucks, according to court documents. Espindola allegedly organized and directed hundreds of pounds of shipments to South Dakota, Colorado, Massachusetts, Washington, and North Carolina. Investigators seized three handguns and nearly 11,000 plants at the El Dorado County site. Court documents revealed that nearly 17,500 plants were seized from Placer County's grow site and another 2,000 marijuana plants at the Tehama County grow site. So, Mr. Ochoa Espindola was sentenced to 17 and a half years for growing about 30,000 marijuana plants that they were able to find. And so he won't get out of prison until somewhere around 2031, close to November of 2030. Now, while he's in prison, he might get a chance to meet our next contestant, Marquise Montgomery. Using my time-honored technique of, well, he was just busted in El Dorado County, Placer County, Tehama County, I went to the Google News and I typed in El Dorado County child rape sentence, Placer County child rape sentence, and Tehama County child rape sentence. And also when I play this game, because there's so many results, I usually try to limit it to just a result that has been within the past season or so. You know, the past 3 to 6 months, right? Because if you go way, way back, I'm sure you can find, you know, anything, right? But within the past 6 months of this guy getting sentenced to 17 and a half years in prison for 30,000 marijuana plants, I found this story from Fox Sacramento in December of 2012. Marquise Montgomery has pleaded no contest to charges of raping and impregnating a severely mentally and physically handicapped woman and causing great bodily harm. The great bodily harm would be the impregnation. He faces 8 years in prison for the rape, plus 5 more for causing great bodily harm. 13 years total. So if our grower does meet Marquise, he'll have to say goodbye to Marquise sometime in 2026. He'll still be doing 5 more years of his sentence for growing pot plants when the guy who raped the blind, mentally handicapped, in a wheelchair, physically disabled woman, the guy who raped her will be out 5 years sooner. Or even actually, possibly, probably sooner than that, because California is beset by prison overcrowding and all sorts of federal court decisions that mandate early release for some prisoners. Not pot-growing prisoners, however, because pot-growing prisoners are sentenced under mandatory minimums that make early release impossible. And this guy, this Marquise Montgomery, he was like a nurse's assistant, an orderly, if you will, at the care facility where this woman was raped. And they didn't even know she was raped until she was about 6 months along and they could see she was pregnant. That guy gets less time than a pot grower. no logical, moral, or ethical reason that should be so, and there's nothing we can really say about it but to smoke some weed. Agreed.
Bullshit world we live in. Let's try and forget some of that.
Yeah, you almost need weed to deal with how badly weed is treated.
Absolutely. Have you ever
we'll be right back. Got new Cheech and Chong music coming up. Stay tuned. To China, he would send you South Carolina. Then you know you're talking to that reefer man.
Hey everybody, welcome. It's Danny Danko from High Times Magazine, and I'm here with Mr. Kyle Cushman, and we're talking about integrated pest management. Now Kyle, I see you're using these yellow sticky traps. What's the purpose of those?
It is just a good part of routine IPM, integrated pest management, along with neem oil, regular spraying of neem oil every second or third day. And it's just good to keep down to prevent an infestation before it happens.
Okay.
So it's kind of like that canary in the coal mine thing where it'll let you know ahead of time by seeing how many bugs there if you need to employ something stronger, if you're going to need to use biological controls or some chemical insecticides.
Wow, cool. And also I'd like people to know the reason these sticky traps are yellow is that the bugs are attracted to that color. It's the color of a dying leaf, which makes a welcome home for them. So always remove any yellowing leaves so as not to create a home for pests.
Yes. Yellow or mottled leaves. Go away.
All right. Well, thank you very much, Kyle. And this has been a lesson in integrated pest management.
Fun.
What's happening, cool cats? This is Big Daddy. And I want you to cruise on over to the Funky Roller Rink. We'll be grooving all night long. Doors open at 11 Eastern, 8 Pacific, every Thursday night, right here on RadicalRuss.com.
Funky. Delicious.
Everyone knows music and marijuana go together, so let's wind up our 20 after break with the Russ Belville Show's Daily Toker Tunes, the best in pod-safe 420 music from around the web. Today is Electric Tuesday, featuring the latest in electronic dance music and other cutting-edge genres. You can get downloads and more information about all our Daily Toker Tunes by visiting music.radicalrust.com. Now, sit back and enjoy your Daily Toker Tunes.
Welcome back, and again, big thanks to Dom Music and Caitlin out there who reached out to 420 Radio for our latest promotion. We are working with Cheech and Chong's animated movie, their public relations team, for the musical soundtrack album, and debuting five new tracks right here on the Russ Belville Show. You've already missed the first two, but if you go back to the past two episodes, you can find them on youtube.com/radicalrus. And right there at about the 23-minute mark is where you'll hear them. We've already played a couple others. The Cheech and Chong anthem, Weed Are the World. Yesterday, we played Medical Marijuana Blues. And today, we get to play, and I thought it was Paranoid Pothead, but I think that's tomorrow's tune. Today, we get to play Smoke a Doobie Time, which is kind of their electronic-y song. And that's one thing I've always appreciated about Cheech and Chong is they've got a wide musical range where, you know, they'll go everywhere from R&B, you know, classic R&B sounds, to blues, to rock, and now this kind of electronic thing. You know, they did a lot of that electronic stuff in the early 80s as they moved on to that Get Out of My Room album and all that kind of stuff. So let's just get to the music and have a good time. It's Cheech and Chong with Smoke a Doobie Time.
Dougie.
Oh, Doug, hi.
Over here.
Look what I have.
Ooh, what do you have? Ooh, X.
Yeah. You want some?
Oh, give it to me right away.
No, I'll turn around. I'll give it to you.
Oh, so soon? Okay.
The smoke, the weed, the herb, the sea. I smoke that Buddha cause it relaxes me. The mota, the yesca, the ganja, and the burrito. I vaporize a cannabis to boost my libido. The dope, the indica, the hydro mind. I pack the bowl and then I pull that chronic. The boom, the reefer, the skunk, the blunt. I search for the kind like I'm on a treasure hunt. I got my business all locked up.
I've got an overflowing cup. Now put your hands to the sky. Come on, everybody, let's get high. Oh ho, oh ho, oh ho ho ho. It's smoke a doobie time. Oh ho, oh ho, oh ho ho ho. It's share a doobie time. Oh ho, oh ho, oh ho ho. It's smoke a doobie time. Mary and the Johnny. I blaze that rope and then I chill like a zombie. The joint, a doobie, a fatty, or a spliff. I hold them in between my ingrate roach cliff. The grass, the giggle, the jive and the kazizzle. I smoke two joints and my body starts to tingle. The buds, the chiba, the tea, the sativa. My medicine is a bottle of the Sensimilla. I got my business all locked up. I've got an overflowing cup. Now put your hands to the sky. Come on, everybody, let's get high. Oh ho, oh ho, oh ho ho ho. It's smoke a doobie time. Oh ho, oh ho, oh ho ho ho. It's sheer a doobie time. Oh ho, oh ho.
Marijuana right for you? When you are stricken by an illness, injury, or disability, you deserve to live your life as free from pain and suffering as possible. Modern medical researchers have developed some amazing pharmaceutical drugs, but these may not be the best solution for you. At Alternative Medical Choices, we help collect your medical records history and provide a physician's review and examination to help you qualify for the use of medical marijuana in Oregon and Washington State. Call 971-270-0262 or visit altmedchoices.com for more information and to schedule an appointment today. Alternative Medical Choices, because you deserve the best in healthcare.
On the road again.
Hi, this is Willie Nelson. Friends, it's time we legalize the responsible use of marijuana and stop treating marijuana smokers like criminals. We're destroying the lives and careers of hundreds of thousands of good, hard-working Americans every year in this country for no good reason. There's absolutely nothing wrong with smoking pot. For more information on how you can help legalize marijuana, please contact Normal at norml.org.
Activism begins with ACT. The Russ Belville Show features the stories of hardworking grassroots activists working for an end to prohibition in today's activist agenda.
All right, welcome back, everybody. Just about half past the hour here. And for today's activist agenda, we're doing a little feature that I like to call Reefer Research. And that's when we take a look at the different government and statistical and scientific websites that are out there providing all of the information you need to make your point in any particular drug war argument. And for today's Reefer Research, being that there's so much talk from Kevin Sabet and the Project Sam people about rehab, I thought we'd look at the rehab statistics from the treatment episode data set admissions. This is called TEDS A, and it's recent up to 2010. And what got me on this had to do with a tweet that I saw that Doug Benson was on the Adam Carolla show with Dr. Drew, or on the Dr. Drew show with Adam Carolla. I don't know exactly how it went down. But anyway, Dr. Drew, Adam Carolla, and Doug Benson are all together. And I tweeted out, "Doug, run before Dr. Drew puts a bunch of heroin in your trunk and then calls the cops." This references back to a tweet war that I had with Dr. Drew directly. He had had a statement in Huffington Post where one of the times Lindsay Lohan got in trouble, he said, if I were her father, I would load her car up with a bunch of Schedule I drugs and then send her on her way and then call the cops to get her pulled over so she'd get busted so she'd be forced into rehab. Yeah, so I was just referencing that. Anyway, it got me to thinking about rehab, and that led me, once again, back to the Substance Abuse Mental Health Data Archive, or SAMHDA. You can find this, it's a tough link, and I think I've got a short link to it through my Rad Russ facility. I'll put the long link in the chat room right now if people want to follow along. But this is where you can find all of this information, and we'll put it up on the screen as well for you from the Substance Abuse Mental Health Services Archive, or SAMHSA, which is the government agency that controls these statistics. And here we go. Let's see if I can resize this, make it a little easier for y'all to see. All right, so SAMHSA, there we go. Get that just about the right size. All right, so this is the Mental Health Data Archive, and from here you can choose different selections like the Drug Abuse Warning Network. This is the stats on emergency room admissions based on drugs. Health Behavior and School-Age Children, National Survey on Drug Use and Health, that's probably the primary one you want to look at. That's all of the statistics, who uses how much, so forth. But here it is. Here's the one we're looking for today, the Treatment Episode Data Set Admissions, or TEDS-A. And when you open that up, you'll find, you know, the list of all the surveys going back, you know, through all the years. We're just going to pick the most recent, the TEDS-A for 2010. Now, when you get to the TEDS-A for 2010, there's these different sections of the page that you work with. And in the top left is your variable selection. On the right here, what's going to go in your rows, columns, controls, and so forth. Now, this is difficult when you first get to these things because there's not like a help file that, you know, gives you this nice guide as to how you plug things in and what to do. Everything I've learned about this TEDS database has I've gotten just from poking around in it and trying to figure out how it works. And it helps a little bit that I have some background in database stuff. But right here in this bottom right corner, and let me get some of the graphics out of the way here so that you can see better what I'm trying to pull off. But right here in the corner, you can see the different variables that are available. They look like a set of books. And the books just represent the different subjects. And there's one subject here that says referral sources. And within referral sources are two variables called P source, principal source of referral, and debt crim, detailed criminal justice referral. Now, you come upon that and maybe you have a clue. Maybe like, well, principal source of referral, that kind of sounds like why they got put into rehab. And it actually is. And there is a help up here. If you can look in this help to get some of these details. But I usually find that the easiest way to figure these things out is just plug them in and see what comes out. For example, what is P source? Well, if I click on P source, it'll put it, it's your bladder. That's the P source. No. When I click on P source here as the variable, you can then copy that to row, and that'll move it over to the row section here. You only have to have a row. That's the bare minimum. You don't have to put anything else in. You just pick P source here to try to like, what the hell is P source? Let's figure this out, right? And if you scroll to the bottom, there'll be a place, run the table, and the data will appear. And what this is telling us is that for the row, using the variable P source, which stands for principal source of referral, there's a range of 1 to 7 that can be. And when you scroll down, you find out what those things are. A code 1
is somebody who refers themselves to rehab. A code 2 is when a drug or alcohol abuse care provider is sending him to rehab. And so forth. We have other healthcare provider, educational school, employer EAP, other community referral. Those can be, you know, community like YMCAs or whatever, anything in the community that might refer someone to rehab. And then finally, court, criminal justice, DUI, DWI. Now, when we just pulled just this one variable, we are pulling the variable for everyone who ever went to rehab in 2010. This is for marijuana, for coke, for heroin, for LSD, for alcohol. If they went to rehab, this is what sent them there. And what we discover is 36.9% of the people who ended up in rehab were put there because of a court, criminal justice referral, DUI, or DWI. They got in trouble with drugs under the law, or alcohol, DWI, right, under the law, about a third of the people in rehab, more than a third, 36.9%, are in rehab because they were forced there. And about a third, actually almost exactly a third, 33.1%, are there because they referred themselves. They decided they had a problem and they went on their own. For the rest of this little demonstration, we're only going to compare the individual self-referrals to the court criminal justice system ones. And the reason I'm doing that, because the court criminal justice ones are the ones that are forcing you to rehab. The individual ones are the ones you're choosing to go to rehab. The rest of these are somewhere in between. Now, if your employer is sending you rehab, maybe you're choosing to go to keep your job. Maybe that's not much of a choice when your job's at stake. Let's not even worry about that. Let's consider about a third of the people in rehab are there because they went on their own. About a third of people in rehab because the court sent them there. All right, so if that's what we're going to do, let's go back to our treatment episode data source. We've got the P source. We know that what that is. That's what sent you to rehab. Now we'd like to know what drug got you put in rehab. And if you scroll down in this bottom left corner and you find these substances of abuse, there's original variables and there's created variables. And all these variables have to do with what substance were they using? Which way did the route of administration, you know, they shoot it? Do they smoke it? Frequency of use, age at first use. And I'm not going to take you through those because through time, you know, for time constraints, I just found that they weren't very useful. But within substance of abuse created variables, we do find some very useful ones. All of these variables that end with FLG are flags. They are binary yes, no type of things. And they are, did they report alcohol? Did they report cocaine? Did they report marijuana, heroin, non-prescription methadone, opiates or synthetics, PCP, hallucinogens, meth, amphetamines, stimulants, benzodiazepines, etc., 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 right? So any one of these drugs, it's either a yes or no that that person's in rehab for it. But there's a problem. There is a problem, and that is because you could go to rehab for multiple drugs. You could go because of alcohol and marijuana and LSD for that matter, right? Now, you might just be the drunk. You just might be a drunk who happens to use pot or acid from time to time. But as far as it gets coded in the database, you've got a problem with all three, right? So we got to narrow this down a bit. We can't just say, you know, whether or not you were in for marijuana, because you might have been put in for marijuana and heroin. Well, you know, you really probably have the problem with heroin. But there's this nice one right up here, numb subs. And that stands for the number of substances that were listed when the person was admitted. Now, where this becomes useful is you'll find this button here that says filter. With num subs, I can click filter, and it puts it down here in this selection filter area right there. And there's parentheses, and you can put a number in there. Well, we want just one substance. People that were put in rehab just for marijuana. Here's what we're going to do with this. Let's take marijuana flag, M-A-R-F-L-G, marijuana reported at admission, and we'll put that in the column. And then let's take P source, what sent you to rehab, and put that in the row. And that fills in our little variables here, right? Our rows are going to be why you went to rehab. Our column's going to be you're in for marijuana or you're not in for marijuana, true or false. And there was only one substance when you went in. You're not a multi-drug addict. You either went in for booze or coke or heroin or marijuana, right? And with all of that, we'll come down here. Now, remember, when we did this for just everybody in rehab, it was about even. One third went to rehab for self-referral. One third went there because the court forced them to. Run this table. And here's what you get. For column on the right, substance reported. This would be people who went to rehab for marijuana and only marijuana, because it's only one substance. 13.6% of them are self-referrals. 55.6% of them are criminal justice referrals. And we can compare that to people who didn't report marijuana. That would be they're in rehab for something other than pot. That would be drugs and alcohol, drugs or alcohol. 36.2% sent themselves. 36.0% were referred by criminal justice. So that balance overall of one third sent themselves, one third went there for court is the way it is for every drug and alcohol combined. As you know, people that did not use pot, it's a one third, one third. People who did use pot, it's a 1 to 5. For every one person there who went on their own for rehab, there are 4 who were forced there by the criminal justice system. Now, if that doesn't shake your foundations a little bit, how about this little change? If we put debt crim up there, debt crim is the variable that tells you if you were sent there by a court, what was the court sending you there for? The result there, 44.6% are there for a probation or parole violation. That generally means they were caught with weed while they were on probation, or they tested positive on a P-test. Compare that to the non-marijuana column, where it's 26% busted their probation. The stats are all there. Email me, russ@radicalrust.com, if you need some help with them. I'm here for you. When we come back, time for a radical rant. We're going to tear down Project Sam.
You're tuned into the Russ Belville Show, the voice of the marijuana nation. Normal stands for responsible adult cannabis use. If cannabis use is causing problems in your life, consider taking a break or seeking medical assistance. Consider ceasing cannabis use if you have a family history of mental illness. Don't drive or operate heavy machinery while impaired by cannabis use. Cannabis use is not without risks, even though the risks may be far less than those posed by legal drugs. You want to legalize it? Call your congressman today. 202-224-3121. It's free, it's easy, and you don't even have to give your name, just your zip code, and they'll hook you up to your congressman. Call 202-224-3121 and tell Congress you support marijuana legalization.
Liberate your mind.
You want answers?
I'm as mad as hell, and I'm not going to take this anymore.
You want answers?
You have offended my family.
I think I'm entitled.
You want answers?
I want the truth.
And you have offended a Shaolin temple.
You can't handle the truth.
Surely you can't be serious.
I am serious, and don't call me Shirley.
Radical rant.
All right, folks, once again, I set my sights on Kevin Sabet and Project Sam because they're out there and I can't resist. I got this news piece from Hawaii247.com, and it's entitled, As State, County, Mull Marijuana Laws, Project Sam Seeks Smart Approaches. I love it. Thank you for using Smart Approaches. Every time Smart Approaches is near Project Sam, you give me another web hit. God, I love it. Oh, it's so beautiful. But anyway, Karen Stanton's writing this. She's an editor there at Hawaii 24/7, and she's pointing out the decrim bill got shot down in the state house. The state Senate had previously passed it. And the county council for the Big Island was going to vote March 28th on a resolution in support of decrim, but the council member withdrew the resolution before the new council members could vote on it. And as this is going on, of course, Project Sam has shown up out there on the Big Island saying that Hawaii is one of a handful of states targeted for legalization by marijuana advocates. There's actually a really good story on Rolling Stone, and I was going to bring this up in Hour 2, Toker Talk Radio. We'll talk a little bit more about it. But Rolling Stone has an article on the seven states that are most likely to pass marijuana legalization in the coming years. And I don't have that link really quick, but anyway, they point out that Hawaii is definitely one of them. Vermont, Maine, Rhode Island, Oregon, Nevada, California, and Hawaii were the seven states that were pointed out. So they point out, you know, Project Sam with Patrick Kennedy was there, the former representative who wrecked two cars twice in a 3-week span in 2006 while high and drunk and never saw the inside of a jail cell. Yeah, that's him. Patrick Kennedy and Kevin Sabet, who's the University of Florida's Drug Policy Institute director. And they said the group is forming a Hawaii chapter in an effort to provide fresh approaches to marijuana policies, ones that use science, public health, and public safety principles as a guide. Project Sam bills itself as, quote, a group of experts and knowledgeable professionals advocating for a fresh approach that neither legalizes nor demonizes marijuana. And now we will go through the rest of the story where they demonize marijuana. Okay. A fresh approach that neither legalizes nor demonizes. Well, all right. So if there's nothing to demonize about marijuana, why must it remain illegal? That's always the sticking point for me, but we'll see if they can explain. In this piece, it's remarkable, and I've got to give Kevin Sabet and Patrick Kennedy kudos on this from a marketing perspective and from a public relations standpoint. These guys stick to their talking points. They really stick to their talking points. And if you've been a longtime fan of the show, you've heard me debunk these 1,000 times. Get ready for 1,001, because if they keep repeating them, I'll keep debunking them. They say opium has medical value. It's called morphine, but we don't smoke opium to get morphine. So why smoke crude raw marijuana to get its medical value? Well, on the one hand, it's kind of nice they admit marijuana has medical value, isn't it? They just said, why smoke it to get its medical value? Oh, so it has medical value. So keeping raw crude marijuana on Schedule 1 and saying it has no medical value, you don't agree with that either, do you? You don't think it should be Schedule 1. You just said it has medical value. But regardless, I want to turn to Jillian Galloway, who's a commenter. I've found her on the internet a few times. I think she even is a fan of the show, although I can't confirm it. But we see each other in comment sections. And she's got the greatest answer. For the longest time, I've been giving the answer of, you know, well, we don't chew willow bark to get the benefit from aspirin, but we don't throw anyone in prison for chewing willow bark, do we? Here's her line. I love this. Well, why eat oranges to get vitamin C? After all, aren't they also crude and raw? Yeah, there is a medical benefit from oranges. It's called vitamin C. But we still eat oranges, right? It's still okay to eat oranges. Even though you can get a gummy bear, they got gummy vitamins for vitamin C now. You can get a hard cap vitamin for vitamin C. You can get all sorts of drinks that are infused with vitamin C. There's all sorts of ways to get vitamin C, but no one stops you from eating a damn orange or throws you in prison for growing an orange tree. Now, of course, Kevin Sabet was a, yeah, but oranges don't get you high. Yeah, but we'll get to that in just a second. While a marijuana plant can contain 400 chemicals, he said, only 50 to 60 components help ailing people. Okay, this is the old marijuana contains 400 chemicals. You know what else contains 400 chemicals? Lots of things. Coca-Cola, Gatorade, Twinkies. There's lots of things that contain lots of chemicals. The number of chemicals something has is in no way indicative of what its harm may be. Doesn't matter. Arsenic does not have that many chemicals in it. It's got arsenic, but it will kill you. All right. This thing, the 50 or 60 components that help ailing people, those would be the cannabinoids, the flavonoids, the terpenes of the whole marijuana plant that work together synergistically. Trying to take them apart and make them separate pills, it might be beneficial for certain applications. But if the raw plant itself has such low side effects and low incidence of harm, why stop people from using that if they wish to? I'm sure aspirin is probably more effective than chewing willow bark. Probably because you got a direct dose. You know how much you're getting. It's pure. Doesn't taste like bark. But, I mean, we're not stopping people from using willow bark if they choose. What is this about marijuana where it must be, you must use the most effective medicine? You can't possibly use this natural one if it's not possibly as effective, which, by the way, it's much more effective. But even if it weren't, why would it be required that we have to use the most effective? It just makes my head hurt. In addition, he said there are at least two pills in a spray that contain the helpful ingredients but don't require smoking. Yeah, you know what else doesn't require smoking? Vaporizing doesn't require smoking. Neither do edibles. Neither do tinctures. It's always the smoking you come back to. That's what you got a problem with. We got a solution for it. It's a red herring at this point. Then Kennedy jumps in. Kennedy got to jump in with his sound bite, his big tobacco sound bites. Those are coming. But he says, for every dollar the government spends in from taxation of alcohol and tobacco, every dollar the government brings in from taxation of alcohol and tobacco, it spends 10 on social costs. Right. Alcohol and tobacco are, say it with me, kids, toxic and addictive. Of course they're going to cost a lot more, he points out. The costs we know we will see include more emergency room visits. Okay, well, who visits emergency rooms for pot? Nobody. Who visits emergency room from alcohol overdoses? Lots of people. Who visit emergency rooms because asthma, emphysema, chronic obstructive pulmonary disease? That'd be tobacco smokers, not pot smokers. Treatment admissions. No, the only way you're going to see more treatment admissions, Patrick, is if marijuana is illegal and merely having it is significant enough cause to put you in rehab. The stats I just went over prove that. If marijuana is legal, you lose 4 rehabbers for every one who sent themselves in. Nobody would like to see their business go down like that, would they? And car crashes? Really? Car crashes. You know the joke about stoners, right? Sitting at the stop sign waiting for it to turn green. The only thing that stoners are going to do driving is miss their exit. They are not a big harm on the roads. You know it. I know it. We all know it. All right. Bring some honesty into this. Is a person who smokes pot, just general person, not person with tolerance, not person with experience, average, normal human being, make them smoke pot, are they a better driver? No. But they're aware they're not a better driver. This is the difference between alcohol and marijuana that people won't fess up to. The problem with alcohol is not only does it impair your ability, it impairs your judgment. While you become a worse driver, you think you're a better driver. You take more chances. Marijuana is the opposite of that. People actually self-rate their ability to drive while they're under marijuana, the effect of marijuana, lower than their actual ability really is. That is to say, people who are stoned are better drivers than they think they are. And will actually not get behind the wheel when they really probably could. We're cautious that way. We're not afraid of the car crashes. Oh, he also continued. Well, we'll also see an increase in mental illness and learning problems. Mental illness and learning problems. Increased incidence. Because people will smoke pot and go crazy and not know how to learn. Nobody ever got through medical school or the bar exam that was a pot smoker. That never happened because it causes learning problems, right? And these costs will only increase as marijuana becomes more available. Becomes more available? More available. 91% of the high school drug dealers are dealing marijuana. 91%. 44% of the kids in school today know their high school drug dealer. And 91% of those high school drug dealers can get them marijuana. And these kids can say they can get it easily within a day. And you say it's going to be more available when they have to corrupt an adult to go to an adult-only store to get it. More available. All right. Then again, he points out the whole big tobacco thing. The tobacco companies going after the kids. The tobacco companies have admitted they need to keep expanding their customer base to keep making money. Here's the difference. With tobacco, it's a noxious, terrible habit to have. If you don't get sucked into it by the time you're 15 years old by thinking, you know, it's cool and you'll get laid or whatever, if that hasn't happened by the time you're 21 or 22, you smoke a cigarette and go, fuck this is awful. With alcohol, there's a similar thing at play, and there's the effect that as you get older, you get my age, you get in your mid-40s, 50s and so, drinking a whole lot just doesn't work for you. You just can't, you know, it's not going to happen. As marijuana becomes legal, you're not going to see a huge jump in teenage use. You're going to see a huge jump in the AARP use. You're going to see people 50 and older smoking pot. You're going to see the baby boomers who tried it back in Woodstock who are getting back on the train and realizing, hey, I can smoke weed, giggle, have some great sex with my lady, and when I wake up, I don't have a hangover. I can smoke a little weed and not get obnoxious and have, you know, the upset stomach and whatever else comes with drinking alcohol. I can have myself a relatively good time and still go to work in the morning, be a functioning human being. That's where you're going to see the growth of marijuana. And that's what Patrick Kennedy and all those people don't want to see happen. They don't, their friends, they're in the alcohol and in the marketing of prescription pharmaceuticals, you know, the pill to help your depression and then the pill to help your pill that helps your depression. They don't want to see people smoking a joint and feeling good. The people that make the Ambien, and then if the Ambien doesn't work for you, the new one that you take in the middle of the night for just a little bit of sleep, what's that new one called? I can't even remember anymore. There's so many, and I'm sure it's got a Z in it, but they don't want to see you smoking a doobie and getting a good night's rest. Let's see, what else has Sabet got in here for me? Sabet said marijuana doesn't have a measurable dose like alcohol or prescription medication. Are you? Of course it does. It's called, oh, that's enough. It's self-titration. That's what it is. Alcohol and prescription medication go into your gut and take 10, 20, 30, 40 minutes before you feel anything. That's why they have to have measurable doses. Marijuana, you smoke some. Was that enough? I'll smoke a little more. Was that enough? Yeah, that's enough. That's the way pot works. It's not alcohol or prescriptions. And please, you gotta end my rant with marijuana available now is 5 times more powerful than the 80s and 10 times more powerful than the 60s. Have you seen the video from Woodstock? Those are not the clothes and actions of people with weak weed. No, sir. That's some good weed. There's always been good weed. And we actually want to see better weed in a legal environment. You want to know why that potency's gone up, and it hasn't gone up 5 or 10 times. It's gone up 2.5 times. But you want to know why that potency goes up is because prohibition creates a market force that requires dealers to increase the potency to compete in a market. They can't differentiate their product any other way. You're in fact going to see a boom in lower THC high quality strains once we get legalization. A lot of that baby boom generation doesn't want to have their lights knocked out when they smoke a doobie. They just want to get high. You're going to see so much change from legalization that looking back on these Project Sam missives in just 4 years are going to look as silly and ridiculous and as obscene as reading some of the missives from the Jim Crow era South or some of the anti-gay ravings of the Westboro Baptist Church. You're in the same league as Fred Phelps, and that's as much respect as you get from me. Wow, that's all the time we got for today, but we'll take some of this into hour two. We got Bacon Dan and Brian the Red hanging out with us. We'll also take your calls at 971-533-7111. Thanks for joining us. Stay tuned for Toker Talk Radio, and until next time, take care of each other, Tokers.
This is the Russ Belville Show.
The Russ Belville Show is blogging and podcasting daily at RadicalRuss.com.
You take a seat, you plant it, you grow it, you giant, you roll it, you smoke it. You take a seat, you plant it, you grow it, you giant, you